John.
Thanks.
Okay, I'm going to sit here. I've got the task now of dealing with, again, with the technology. So let's just see if this one works. We're going to be handing over to London, to the editor-in-chief of The Economist, Zanny Minton Beddoes, very shortly. She's going to be interviewing the Prime Minister of Luxembourg as part of the first session in the London Pride and Prejudice. Before Zanny comes on, I mean, I'll just say a couple of things. I mean, one, and I'm not sure whether I'm over searching too much for something here, but I thought I could detect, and obviously we are talking about a room full of people who are probably like-minded in a way, and many of the people on stage like-minded, but I thought I could detect a nuance, a shift in the nuance of the discussion, the conversation that was happening today. Last year we really focused around the business case, but quite a few of the people who spoke today, and indeed some of the comments from the floor, clearly articulated the idea that actually it's just the right thing to do and let's just get on with it. And, you know, quite clearly it's a business case, the business case is important, but that too is, I think, the beginning of a conversation that seems to me to be quite clear, and it's certainly come through in the discussion today. I think the other thing that I would mention and came out of the last discussion before Zanny comes on was, you know, the wide gap between foreign companies in Asia and domestic companies, but certainly thoughts about how to bridge that gap, how to, in a sense, build, as the last panel was saying, the critical mass to get those companies off the ground and start moving was another very important point. Here she is. Zanny. Hello, Zanny.
Tell us what you have been discussing in Hong Kong, one of the big takeaways from Hong Kong.
Well, Zanny, it's been a fascinating day, I think, a really absorbing day of discussions here about the whole question of how companies and businesses can act as catalysts for change around LGBT inclusion. I'll just mention a couple of things, Zanny, that I take away. One that came out of an earlier session that John was doing, leadership, openness, and visibility. And indeed clear institutional, internal institutional responses to LGBT within companies. Companies need to get those policies in place. Were really very, very clear takeaways, I think, Zanny, from sessions we had today. If companies are going to actually address the diversity gap that they often face. But equally, I think, from the very first session we had today, the sense that millennials, that the younger generation need to be listened to, and they are actually a potent force for driving some of the change in companies as well. And companies would do well, leaderships in companies to do really well to listen to that group of people. And the other thing I think I would mention, Zanny, before you head into your discussions is this sense that, yes, leadership, structure, all of those things are important, but somehow perseverance in this process is also important. Follow through is essential. There is there's a tendency, I think, for companies to talk about these issues, to put ideas in place, but the long-term perseverance around these issues is sometimes difficult to sustain, and quite often that's a question of leadership. Don't lead it, leave it, as I think somebody said, to the HR department. Actually take control and build it into the leadership KPIs in a way. Get leaders involved. The leadership has to be clear about what it wants out of this process.
That's terrific. Did you have any concrete suggestions of how to do that? I mean, clearly leadership means CEO, the C-suite getting involved and pushing hard. What tips did any of your panelists feel about things to do and indeed things not to do?
Well, there were plenty of discussions around concrete areas that companies could actually work on. I mean, first of all, just making sure that the policies were in place was something. There were a couple of companies where there was a feeling that that wasn't necessary. But I think by and large, the general view was that actually make sure there is clarity and make sure there is purpose around policies relating to LGBT. That would be the first thing. There were plenty of other discussions, taking examples from other areas of diversity. So allies, the discussion around allies in diversity, the long struggle for greater levels of gender equality in companies could provide potentially for the LGBT process was certainly another area that provided a few examples. Perhaps even those two diversity areas collaborating a little bit to make sure that there was added weight from the history of the process that had gone on with gender equality, added weight from that into the LGBT question. So a number of thoughts and plenty of examples.
Charlie, as you know, in a couple of minutes, we will have the Prime Minister of Luxembourg, Xavier Bettel, joining us, and I hope you will at least be able to watch the conversation, even if you're not able to ask him questions. But it does raise the question of role models and political leadership, and indeed the political environment. Sometimes many of the countries in your part of the world, that's a little trickier. Did you have a conversation about whether that is changing at all?
Yes, there was a conversation about that, and I think there was very mixed views around that, Zanny. I mean, we've heard today that to some degree there is some movement and some change in public policy areas in some countries in the region, but I think overall the environment remains quite challenging for most countries, and that governments are not especially willing to engage. And I think we had a particular example in one of the sessions, particularly Hong Kong, and I'm sorry to bring this up again, Alfred, but there was certainly a feeling of disappointment, in a sense, that the Hong Kong government is not moving more quickly around things like anti-discrimination legislation, and that it's not filling the opportunity that's there to do so, given that there's quite a widespread feeling amongst many companies in Hong Kong that, particularly foreign companies, but increasingly local companies, we had 75 of them signing a petition very recently that there is a need for more action in this area.
So more to be done in Hong Kong, but in 25 seconds, Charlie, which you've got left, broadly, progress from the year before, this is an agenda that is moving forward in your part of the world.
I got a very positive sense from the discussions today, and a sense that truly there was movement going on. Each year we do this, and I hope we're going to be doing it again. Each year we do this, it seems to mark another point of progress. Yes.
Excellent. Thank you, Charlie Goddard. Now I hope I will be joined by Xavier Bettel, the Prime Minister of Luxembourg, who will be on wonderful technology as well. Good morning.
Good morning, Prime Minister. Wonderful to see you. I'm sorry we couldn't see you in person, but thank you so much for taking the time. You are, of course...
I'm so sorry, but as you can guess, my thoughts are with the citizens of London today, and I had to cancel my trip, but I'm really sorry for what happened.
We totally understand, and we're very grateful that you've joined us like this. It's almost as though you're in the room. So thank you, and you are, of course, you need no introduction. You are Prime Minister of Luxembourg. You are currently, I think, the only head of state who is openly gay in the world. And you introduced in 2014 the Marriage Equality Act in Luxembourg. Why don't we start by giving us a flavor of how you pushed that through and how, in your own country, you have managed to change attitudes and actually make concrete progress?
I think the first step was firstly to break the ice through myself, to accept myself, and as for a lot of LGBT person, it was the first thing, how will people react, how will friends react, how will family react, how will myself react, and when I realized that it was like that, you know, for my mother it was a disaster, but for all my friends they told me, we knew it, but we were just waiting for your message to tell us how it was. My mom is still okay now, she's very happy and she likes my husband, so that's important to know too. Fact is, so this is the first step. And then when I did politics, I started when I was very young, and when I was elected mayor and deputy mayor and then after minister, for me it was just the fact that I was never the gay prime minister, but I'm the prime minister and I'm gay. And this is what for me was important. It's not to to say that because I'm gay, but it was a fact. It is like that. It's not a choice. I'm not waking up in the morning and saying I'm gay today and I was straight yesterday. You told me I'm the open, the only open gay prime minister. That's what the journalists say. I don't know. I don't know all of the leaders in the world, so I can't tell you if I have some other colleagues or not. But the fact is, what is important, I just have one life and I don't want to hide it. And especially in politics, if you want to hide yourself, how can people trust you if you are not able to be what you are? So I'm prime minister and I'm also gay. I was the mayor. I was at that time already also gay. But it's a fact. And what for me, what as you said, to bring legislation through, was the fact to say to people that we don't want to take something away. Give rights to someone, it's the fact to, politics is there for, not to give rights to people without taking rights away to other ones. And I explained it to some other colleagues also on European level that doing step by step was the possibility to have a bill, I think had 54, 56, votes in favor of the bill. I think it was 54 and 60, so I had no debate, and it was like that. People said, okay, we had the civil partnership a few years ago. I did to tell them that with that, Rome didn't disappear because of homosexuality and in the history, and still now everything is going right. Sometimes it's a bit tricky with some colleagues when they invite me to their countries and have to tell them that for me it's maybe too dangerous because I won't hide that I'm gay. And then I have some stories. You have some time for a little story?
I'd love some stories, particularly about your interactions with other prime ministers and other heads of government, because I'm sure there are many who well, I'd love to hear, actually, what is that like?
So I have two different kind of stories. The first story was, for example, Matteo Renzi, prime minister of Italy. He told me, oh, Xavier, I want to do the gay wedding in Italy, and I know you did it, but I have no majority in parliament for the moment. I told him why, but he said, now I have a part of the majority, they want to refuse the adoption. I told him, so just let me give you one advice. Instead of having nothing, do it step by step. Take the adoption away now and do it for the wedding to give rights to people, and the next step in 2 or 3 years where people will see that everything is normal, that nobody died because of that new law, but indeed you give rights to situations, you will be able to pass the other thing. He went back to Italy, he proposed to take the adoption away, and in Italy he passed the bill. And I was a bit surprised because 2 or 3 days later I had Italian press calling me to tell me that I saved the Italian gay wedding bill in the Italian parliament. But this was just by discussing, because I'm the one who thinks it's very important to do step by step and to see that people are able to realize that there is no disaster, that's not a nightmare, just a fact to give rights to people. Another story, which was, I won't tell you which country it was, but it was a president who asked me if I would love to come to visit his country. And then I told him, oh, yes, I would love, but it's too dangerous for me. He said, why? I said, because I'm homosexual and it's still forbidden in your country. And then he answered me, yes, but you don't have to say. I said, I won't hide it. And even I will raise it up during a press meeting. I never got the invitation to visit him now officially. The other topic was... This is a funny story, but I was an MP and I had a meeting in a country, and my partner, my husband now, but my partner at that time, was joining me. And I remember I wrote on the paper, the register form, that I will be joined by my partner, and a man. And so they asked me, are you sure? I said, yes, I'm sure. Okay, but can't you write that it's your assistant and not your partner? So it's your political assistant. And I give just the answer, I prefer the reputation to be gay than to have a sex relation with all my staff. So, and so I went with Gauthier to visit this country and everything was okay, but I was happy when I came back home and I had no troubles in the country.
Those are wonderful stories, but they really do highlight very, very important things, which is, one, the importance of you being a role model and going to, and talking to the, you know, the unnamed prime minister, and indeed the one pointing out the absurdity of the position of the other one. When you go to European meetings, let's start with European ones, you know, do you feel that you have been able to push the conversation, at least amongst your peers, forward in a way that it might not have happened otherwise?
One thing is you said role model. I don't want to be... I did realize that being natural, being like you are, could be a role.
Maybe role model is the wrong word, but it's to be... It does make a difference, I think, in leadership when you have someone like that.
Yeah, I really realized that because I got letters from mothers who wrote me to say, you know, my son is gay or my daughter is lesbian, and to see how successful you are. Reassure me, because I thought that my child could be successful and being gay too. So this was something I was very surprised. And then when I got married with Gauthier, for us it was a normal thing. And I've got a really amazing amount of letters and a very nice letter from President Obama, who wrote me that for me it was maybe a natural decision, but it was it made history. And it was the first Prime Minister getting married with his husband in his position would be an important sign. And then we realized that, and I was surprised because we got married, we wanted not to make it, you know, no paparazzi things. We wanted just to have the family and friends, but we didn't hide it at all. And when we went out of the city hall, we had so many people there to congratulate us. So it was just being like you are. And on European level, I had some colleagues who I invited for my wedding. So I had the Belgian Prime Minister, I had the Estonian Prime Minister at my wedding. Some of my colleagues were not able to come, but I think it's not a point really that is a point of discussion, but believe me, I will be the defender of diversity. I'm gay, it's a fact, but what I like is diversity. It's that we have differences. The biggest problem nowadays, if you have some politicians who think we should all fit in this little box and we have to be like they want us to be, and that's a nightmare. The diversity is the strength of our community, and living together, accepting every kind of life, as long as you don't hurt next one's life, because you would take away his liberty, is something we have to realize. And especially now, where in time of populism, where some people think that the differences makes us weak, it's really my biggest fight to fight against that, because I really believe my country, we are now a very prosperous country, but we never should forget where we come from. And it was because we took away walls, the history of my country, 150 years ago, we took away our fortress. Europe, for me, is to take away walls. So when I see some countries who think that the answer are national solutions and building new walls, it's not also my idea of a Europe I want.
Well, you mentioned a Europe building walls. We're not exactly building walls, but I'm afraid I can't resist the subject of Brexit in this, because we are, of course, about to start the negotiations to leave the European Union. And there is a question of what Brexit impact it will have on LGBT rights and diversity and and that whole discussion in the United Kingdom. Do you have any thoughts on that?
There are two different things, because we have also the European Convention of Human Rights, which is one part where you don't need to be a member of the European Union to be a member of the convention. I know that in Great Britain it was always a big discussion about judges deciding for themselves. For me, it would be very important that the UK would still want to fulfill and to respect also the European Convention of Human Rights. And I'm convinced there is no wish to say that you don't want to go in another direction. The fact is, you speak about dues rights, but it's the same for also straight people, for pensions, for security, for health insurances and all this stuff. You know, I deeply regret the referendum, the result. I respect it, but I regret it, because I really think that it's a lose-lose situation. It's not good for the UK, and it's not good for Europe. We are in a family where sometimes you have good moments and more difficult moments, but now the divorce has been asked by the UK government officially. We got the information that now the Article 50 will be triggered. But I still... I said it a bit on a provocative way a few weeks ago. You still have the opportunity to say, we love you so much that we want to stay in the family, and then we can see if we find solutions. But we had the Luxembourgish presidency where we started with the Brexit, and we finished with the discussion about the Brexit. It is in Europe for the moment so important to remember that after Second World War, we decided to go around the table and to build something in common. And maybe most of us forget what Europe brought us, that we are now able to have those rights I just said before, to have the possibility to travel, to work, to live, to fall in love, to be defended, to have political rights, to be sick, to be health, to get health insurance, to have all these rights and liberties in Europe. And we think that peace is granted. We should not forget that just at the border of the European Union, we have in Ukraine a conflict situation, and it's not that far away. So we should fight for the values we believe in, and we should never forget that Europe's first aim was a peace project, and it is working since 60 years.
How much do you worry that those rights and that progress and the peace and stability and prosperity that the European Union has brought over the last 60 years, the European project, how much do you worry that that is under threat, not only or perhaps not even mainly from Brexit, but from the rise of populism in many countries in Europe?
I think there are a few things. We should never forget that Europe has been built for citizens by citizens. So we have. It's very important to explain also what I just said before. When I go, I studied in Greece. I studied in France and I studied in Greece also. And during the weekend, I went, for example, to Skopje or to Istanbul by car. Customs were closed because they watched the football team. And I'm not that fond of football at that time, so I didn't know how long it would be closed. But then I've got to explain it was 2 times 45 minutes, so I waited for 45 minutes to get through. Second thing was I had to clean my car, not to bring microbes in another country. So imagine the situation where we are not asking ourselves when we go somewhere, when we study somewhere, when we want to work somewhere, when we want to go on holiday. We don't realize what Europe is. So what would be important is to continue to explain what is Europe. But second thing is we should continue some progress. The roaming topic, which is we all have at the end of the month a bill of our phone. And now, because of Europe, we will be able to raise down the roaming bills of all the citizens. These are little examples. And we had a discussion now if we should have a Europe of two speeds, of one speed. I am a defender of a Europe of one speed, but I'm not the hostage of one country. So if one doesn't want to work and doesn't want to continue, okay. But we shouldn't be a hostage and not able to work on. So I prefer a Europe of two speeds than a Europe without any speed.
We have here a room of business leaders. This is, as you know, our second Pride and Prejudice conference, and we're really hoping at the end of today to not just have had a conversation, but to push the agenda forward, to really get businesses, all of us, engaged in what can we do more effectively to promote the broad diversity agenda. From your position and your experience now as leader, Prime Minister of a country, what advice would you have for those of us, for all of us here in the room, of what kinds of things we should focus on?
I think you have a huge responsibility as a business and as a leader to show that differences in your company is a strength. And I met, for example, I participated in Davos, also at some roundtables about LGBT and business. And it's to show that your business is gay friendly, for example. You don't need to be all in pinks now at work tomorrow, but just to show that you are gay friendly. So that someone who knows that he will be in that company and he will have not to hide himself, that he will be able to speak about his homosexuality with his partner, with his working colleague. All this stuff are so important. But as I said before, diversity in general is even more important for me, because when we speak about LGBT, we have also the religions matter, we have the nationalities, and for me it is so important to show that differences, not this one kind of people, is the most important thing in the company. If you are Luxembourger, Catholic or Jew, if you are French, if you are gay, if you are straight, if you are black, if you are white, I don't care. In my company, you are warmly welcome. This is what I really think it's so important. And especially what we have with the LGBT community is that we see, and this is something which makes me very sad, that a lot of young people are not able to live with that situation, and that suicide rates among young people is high about LGBT community because they don't know how to deal with it. And if they see, if you have, for example, the boss of Apple, he's not the gay boss of Apple, but he's the successful Apple boss, and he's also gay, like the Luxembourgish prime minister. So this is what I think it's important not to hide and to prove, as I said before, to parents that you can be successful and being gay. It's not a problem. And it will maybe also help in the company of people who were maybe in the closet before to feel okay and safe to be able to say that that they are not different, but they like someone else. And this is how I did my coming out. So last point, because I started with this, but I remember doing my coming out. I said to my mom, I'm in love. And she said, what's her name? I said, François. And she said, oh, Françoise. No, François. And so I did it. It was a surprise for her. But sometimes it takes time. I didn't want to brutalize her, but I wanted to show her that being different doesn't mean not being successful. And this is really the advice I would give to all the business persons. Be proud about what you are. If you are gay, you are straight, lesbian, you are transgender, Jew, Catholic, Muslim, UK, not UK, in Europe, outside of Europe, just be like you are. You will be just successful when you are able to watch yourself in the mirror and to tell you, I did my job and I am like I am, and they who don't like it, they don't need to vote for me or for you. They should go to someone else. But just be like you are. You will have a much nicer life.
That is a wonderful set of advice. Just one last question. What's on your own to-do list in this area? What does Luxembourg still need to do? Your legislation for trans people perhaps needs some improving.
Yeah, we did all the legislation now about lesbian and gay weddings, all this stuff. So same-sex marriage is open, also the adoption, all these different topics. And we have now the transgender discussion also to see how we can have it on the ID papers. But there is still a discussion. It's ongoing, but we are able to do it without having half of the country against and half of the country in favor, by doing it step by step. And this is what I really advise to all the politicians, to do it step by step by step by step, and able to do it. And I'm very happy that now, for example, when I will go to Rome tomorrow to celebrate the 60th anniversary of the Treaty of Rome, I will be able to be in a country where I know that some of my colleagues are able to show to the others that they are in love. They don't need to hide themselves, and they can openly live their life. And this is what is for me important, and they have rights. Because as a politician, as I told you before, I'm there to give rights to situation and not to blame or to judge.
Well, maybe you can tell your colleagues tomorrow that you've just been to the Pride and Prejudice conference, and perhaps those of them that are still a little behind on this agenda can move a little bit faster forward.
I don't know who you think I should give. I give these advice, but
maybe we'll continue that offline. But I think some of your Eastern colleagues could perhaps do with a little bit of chivying in this direction.
I discussed also with them, and we have meetings. You know, the first union I had was the Benelux Union, where it's Holland and Belgium and Luxembourg. And you see, we are very progressive. We have meetings now with the Visegrad countries. We have meetings also with the Baltic countries. I think they have to do it step by step. As I said, I was very surprised, for example, after my wedding, when I go somewhere, that I can see, I had a friend of mine who called me. He was at the hairdresser in one of these in the eastern part of Europe. And he told me, look what I found at the hairdresser, a whole page about you and Gauthier. So just, I'm happy if I, on a little piece, was able to move maybe for some people. But I'm not the prime minister of other countries. I think people has to vote for the parties they want. I promised that I will do this. I promised that diversity would be one of the things I would defend. And I'm doing what I promised.
And you're doing it more than a little bit. Xavier Bettel, thank you very much indeed for joining us. Goodbye.
Thank you. Welcome to Luxembourg.
Thank you.